we might do stuff that we don't really realize. We get into the routine, we get into habits. Let's observe each other, because you know we can be unconsciously incompetent.
Actively caring for people. What is it? Hi there, I'm Dan Clark with Safety Experts Talk from Creative Safety Supply. Hear more of our podcasts at creativesafetysupply.com/podcast. Today we're talking with Dr. E. Scott Geller, a founding partner of Safety Performance Solutions and a professor at Virginia Tech's Department of Psychology. Dr. Geller is the respected expert on the psychology of safety. Hello, Scott. How are you?
Hey, Dan. I'm doing great. And I like the way you said that, the psychology of safety, because that's what it is. It's the human dynamics of safety. How do we address human dynamics to keep people safe?
Excellent. Let's talk about actively caring for people and maybe how it relates to continuous improvement programs, Lean, 5S, Six Sigma. So class is in session, doctor. Tell us all about it.
Well, I should start by saying it all started in 1979 here at the university. We called it behavior-based safety. Why do we call it behavior-based safety? Because I'm a behavioral scientist, and I'm focusing on changing behavior to improve quality of life. So that's what we call it. And that the principles of behavior-based safety were founded in psychology. And I sat in safety conferences for years, 35 years ago, and safety 35 years ago was all about top-down. Do as I say. The safety cop perspective. And the average worker was not involved. They just had to follow the rules. That's what safety is about. And by the way, at some companies, that's still the way it is. Just follow the rules. There was limited engagement of people. And you can't keep people safe by expecting somebody else to be looking out for them. People have to look out for each other.
When you began, it was about engaging the worker. So how did you engage the worker? Was there behavior observation involved?
Well, let's understand the way it used to be, and it still is. Who follow? OSHA gives you the rules. OSHA, and then the safety director translates those rules into what is safe and what is not safe. We flipped that around. We said, look, the worker on the job, he or she, they know what's safe and what's at risk. So we wanted them to develop a checklist of what is safe behavior and what is at-risk behavior. Notice I don't say unsafe because unsafe sounds too extreme. Just what's risky compared to what's safe. And the workers then develop a checklist. We call it a critical behavior checklist. It's not everything. It can be overwhelming, by the way. So we want to keep it at a, and we actually teach, my partners teach companies how to develop that checklist. But the bottom line is, workers have a discussion. Workers on a team, workers at a particular job site discuss, what are we doing around here that puts us at risk for injury? And see, notice how that becomes a valuable training exercise. When we sit around and we actually put the cards on the table, what are we doing that makes injury a possibility? And what should we do safely to prevent that? That becomes a discussion, an important discussion. And now we develop this checklist, defining each of those safe and at-risk behaviors. And then we agree as a team, let's observe each other. Because, you know, we can be unconsciously incompetent. We might do stuff that we don't really realize. We get into the routine, we get into habits. And by the way, safety should not be a habit. Some of the consultants out say is make safety a habit. No, it's not a habit. We have to be mindful. We have to be thinking. And by having a coaching exercise where an observer is watching us, man, that kicks in the thinking. Now the worker who's working is trying to do everything right. But even when you're trying to do it right, this person can pick up some stuff that's not exactly safe. And that is critical. So there you go. That's the observation systematically with a checklist. And after you've done that, after the observer does this, shows the employee the checklist. And by the way, this is not a gotcha process. The observer shows the employee the work and says, this is what I saw. By the way, today we're calling it humanistic behaviorism. It's humanistic. That is, I want the worker to own up to what they did that was at risk. We're not telling them this is at risky. We're showing them what we saw, and the worker might have some excuses. Oh, wait a minute, this is because the shovel was not nearby, or the correct ladder was not available. Okay, those are comments we make on that checklist so we know what management might need to change or what the workers might need to fix to make safe behavior more convenient. That's the gist. Now, let me tell you what happens. Companies have got a hold of this. Now you translate those numbers into percent safe. And some companies too often have turned this into a numbers game. What's your percent safe? Then they put it on a computer, and that's new data. And since many safety professionals are engineers, this falls right into their ballpark of, oh, we got numbers now, percent safe. But, you know, I'm not saying that's wrong, but they're missing the key ingredient. The key ingredient is the conversation between two workers on the job, one who did the watching and the other who was working. And later on, that role is reversed. And the bottom line is, we're talking about what behaviors put us at risk, and we're talking about it in an interdependent, actively caring way.
For those coworkers that have never had to observe each other and comment on each other's behavior, it sounds like it might be a recipe for conflict, though, because you're not my boss. You can't tell me what to do. Do you have that problem?
Oh, of course, man. And that's why there needs to be training and discussion. And you see, too often we say, never mind why, just go fetch. We tell people what to do, and we don't give them the rationale behind why we're doing it. So that's why training and education is so important, to get the workers to really understand. Listen, you get right down to it. Common sense tells everybody that if we want to keep people safe, we have to communicate in a trusting way. By the way, as you can tell, as you just indicated, interpersonal trust is so important. Names are not reported on these checklists. It's not about who did it. It's about somebody is at risk and we care.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't only care, we actively care. We do something about the care. Of course, we all care. We care about people getting injured, but we don't always act on that caring. So that's why we're calling it today, actively caring for people.
Does that coworker have the authority to stop work?
Well, as you know, in a workplace, workers always have the authority to stop work, you know? But the question is, will they? Because they think, wow, if I stop work, I'm going to stop the process. It will take a long time to kick it back in again, you know? So that is another issue. And of course they should have that. But maybe there are some criteria they have to go through that tell them we need to stop the work process.
I see. Okay.
But Dan, they can't even understand what is risky unless they have these conversations.
So that's part of the training, of course.
Well, and it's also part of the experience of behavioral safety or actively caring for people is to look at the environment and look at the behavior that's occurring in this context and how safe is it? And could we be safer? I mean, that's the value of it. Yes, there's a numbers game. What's the percent safe? And by the way, and a very important point, these checklists do not stay the same. You mentioned Six Sigma. Six Sigma, or continuous improvement, means that we don't use the same checklist every month.
Mm-hmm.
We reach 90% safe. Shoot, man, we're great now. Now we have to manipulate, look at different behaviors. We have to look at the behaviors that are quite challenging. If we're 90% safe, what's the 10%? What are those behaviors that we really have to start focusing on? And my bottom line is to fit this into Six Sigma, these checklists need to be changed as the data tells us that, hey, we're at 90%. Yeah, but you're not. There are other behaviors we need to be looking at. It is all about observing. Feedback. Listen, practice does not make perfect. Only with feedback can we improve. We need supportive feedback. By the way, this is critical too.
Mm-hmm.
We need supportive feedback. People need to know when they're doing it well. People need to feel competent at doing worthwhile work. That's a basic principle of human nature and self-motivation. So that's part of it. It's not only correcting the stuff that needs to be corrected, but it's supporting the stuff that people are doing well.
And you have this checklist that is modified occasionally, and a lot of programs have, after an incident, behavior observation cards. Is this checklist used in that situation too?
Well, this is a behavioral observation card. That's what I'm really talking about, behavioral observation card. But I call it a checklist because it's a list of behaviors that we've talked about as a team. We're willing to observe each other, no names. But again, you say occasionally, this checklist needs to change periodically, and we don't have to wait for an incident or an injury. I don't like the word incident. We move from accident to incident, thank you. But the psycholinguistic folks tell us that an incident is something that's intentional. And it's kind of interesting that the safety world now wants to use the word incident. It's an injury. Let's mm-hmm. tell her what it is. Mm-hmm. It's an injury. Somebody got hurt, or it's a close call. Somebody almost got hurt. And we have to talk about those. Those are the conversations we need. And as soon as we start talking about a close call, people start to say to themselves, wow, this could happen to me. Instead of, oh, it won't happen to me. I will text message while I drive because it won't happen to me. We need to hear about the close calls. We can't wait for the injury before we have these conversations.
You must have some really good stories of people that may have been saved from some kind of accident or injury or death.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a quick one that had a good result?
Yes, and I can tell more often that didn't have a good result. That is, when injuries get and fatalities get evaluated, what we find out is workers saw that individual putting themselves at risk. Mm. I've seen stories and heard stories about a worker who didn't put on fall protection mm-hmm. and fell to their death. And other workers had saw them not put on their fall protection. Clearly, that worker needed a reminder, needed some support, needed a suggestion. But, you know, the silent majority sits back and doesn't say anything. But at the same time, I hear people all the time telling me, thank you. Behavior-based safety increased my awareness, not only of myself, but of my colleagues. And it helped me step to the plate and tell a colleague that could I look out for your safety? See, here's an interesting question. What do you say to a coworker who you see them working at risk? What do you say to them? Hey, you're at risk? That could be a turnoff.
Mm-hmm.
We suggest we call it the foot in the door approach in psychology. Get them to say yes to a question first. The question is, hey, can I look out for your safety?
Oh, perfect.
Of course. How could you say no to that? And now they say yes to that. And then you say, well, I just noticed that you didn't use the handrail when you came down the stairs. And mm-hmm. I know you were safe then, nobody got hurt, but you could. And people, we need you to set the right example. So here's the other important line. You might be not get hurt, but you're setting an example for others. And
right.
Guess what? Somebody's going to get hurt. Your numbers say so. Somebody will get hurt. Do you care? Of course we care. So are you acting on that caring by demonstrating the safe behavior?
Yeah, you're right. If you get enough workers going up and down that stairway without holding onto the handrail, and that's the safety culture or lack of safety culture, boom, somebody's going to get hurt.
Yeah.
And what kind of success have you had with this? When you come into a company, do you have companies that say, well, I don't think we're going to be able to do this, even though we've paid you to consult us?
Sure.
Has anybody just said, no, I don't think we're going to do it?
I have never found anybody object to the term actively caring,
mm-hmm.
right? So clearly, and of course, when we go into a company, when my partners go into a company, they're hired to make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
But they start the training process, and you could have some workers sitting there with their arms folded saying, oh, I don't trust this. Is this another flavor of the month? There's a common statement. Another flavor of the month. Can't wait till this one's over. But we have to speak in a way to let them know that this is not a flavor of the month. And of course, we show them that this kind of process is not only useful for the workplace, this is useful at home, this is useful for your kids, and it's not only for safety. Behavior-based, behavioral science connects to everything. I have a new book coming out called Applied Psychology. When I say applied psychology, by the way, I mean real-world applied psychology. I mean applying the principles of behavioral science to improve human welfare on a large scale. So here's this book. It's called Applied Psychology. It's published by Cambridge University Press, by the way, which is an international publisher. It's the oldest publishing company in the world. It started in the 1500s, so I'm very proud. Mm-hmm. It's 700 pages, and the subtitle is Actively Caring for People. And the reason I bring it up is there's a chapter on coaching, a chapter on alcohol abuse, a chapter on parenting, a chapter on health care, a chapter on obesity. Again, how can we use, as well as a chapter on safety, of course, but how can we use behavioral science to help people do better from driving to working to studying? So it is the principles of behavioral science to improve quality of life.
I just looked that up. It's at cambridge.org.
Okay.
And your own website.
Oh, yeah.
And you have something free on YouTube.
I do have a TEDx talk where I'm talking about another critical point, and that is self-motivation. You know, safety has clearly been top-down, other-directed, meaning other people direct you to be safe. But I'm claiming, and of course, everybody understands this, that's not enough.
Mm-hmm.
We have to be self-directed when it comes to safety, not only to keep ourselves safe, but to keep others safe. So indeed, our book, this new book coming out, by the way, it's not only me. I was the editor and I wrote several chapters, but there were 31 co-authors of this book. Other people out there in the real world, professors, former students of mine, consultants who have used these principles in the home, in the workplace, and so on. But a key chapter in this book is on self-motivation, meaning what can we do to encourage people to be self-directed, to do it not because you told me, but because I'm telling myself.
Uh-huh.
That's a key component. And my TEDx talk, you could Google Scott Geller TEDx, and you can see this. It's only 15 minutes, but it brings out three important points. If you want to promote self-motivation, you need to promote choice, competence, and community. That is, when people feel a perception of choice, they're more likely to be self-motivated. Now, see how contrary that is to the typical way that we promote safety, the traditional way. There's no choice, just do it. With behavior-based safety, who develops the checklist? The people.
Right.
They have choice. When do you do the observations? When it's convenient for you to do the observations. And of course, the observer asks the worker if this is a good time. Choice.
Mm-hmm.
I'm more likely to be self-motivated. How about the word community? When people are more likely to see this as an interdependent, helping process to keep each other safe. That's community. Interdependent. And then, of course, competence. Remember I said earlier that supportive feedback is critical. When people believe that they're competent at doing worthwhile work, they're more likely to be self-motivated. They're more likely to self-direct themselves to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's critical. And there's our new book has a whole chapter on self-motivation. But I've just summed it up right there, and my TEDx talk does a better job. And I hope people would send my TEDx talk to others so they see it and they realize this is what we need. And so not only can we improve our own self-motivation, but we can influence the culture to increase the self-motivation of others.
Great. I'll put a link to that in the podcast post at safetyexpertstalk.com. I have to ask you about your company. And when you consult a company, Do you go in and just talk to them about these processes, or do you go through their facility and inspect their safety processes, or is it simply motivation with the staff?
Oh, thank you for that question. It's first assessment. We have to find out what the company needs. See, one of the problems with so many of these consultants out there is they teach a program, behavior-based safety, or even Six Sigma. I mean, this is a program, and they go into the company and they just set things up the way they have set things up before. That doesn't work. That's when people say, flavor of the month, here we go again. Mm-hmm. You first have to figure out, what does this company need? You need to customize the process, help them customize the process for their culture. Now, by the way, the principles are the same. And I could list the principles, many of the principles right here. One of them is, of course, self-motivation, as I described. The principles are the same, but how you implement those principles, how you put them in place, you need to work with the people, because this is not top-down. This is bottom-up. This is engaging the workforce to do what they need to do to keep each other safe. So I'm glad you asked that question, because my experience is the easy way is to go in with our program. We already have our PowerPoints figured out. We have our worksheets. We just go in and sell you one more program. And sometimes these consultants can be very inexpensive, of course, because they don't have to work with the people on customizing and developing a process for them, for their culture. That's what's missing. And if you just sell a program, programs begin and programs end. But if you customize a process, it can become institutionalized to be part of the culture and continue. Why will it continue? A key principle. Here's a key principle, Dan. Selection by consequences. We do what we do for what we expect to get for doing it. And not only extrinsic consequences, but feeling better about what we're doing, feeling good about what we're doing. So if we can keep showing people that we're gaining, we're improving, we're keeping people safe by this process, it's going to continue.
What's your opinion of the existing plug-and-play safety management programs such as OSHA's VPP or ANSI Z10 or SHARP or any of those?
Well, all of them are better than nothing. But, you know, I want to sound like a salesman here, but I have like three books out there. I mean, you can read one of the books. And by the way, if you go to our website, safetyperformance.com, there's a whole list, not only books. I've written an article every month for Industrial Safety and Hygiene News for 19 consecutive years.
Wow.
Those articles... It's a column called The Psychology of Safety. And those articles are at our website. And you could just go down the list and see which one fits. So this is not easy. It's not as simple as a program. If I could write a different article on the psychology of safety every month for 19 years, you know there's a lot to know about the human dynamics of safety. But that's the challenge that my partners do, is they have all these principles, and we have to see which ones does this particular culture need. But again, pertinent to your question, you can read the material, you can read this stuff in the books, in the articles, and decide for yourself, what do we have to pay attention to? What works best for us?
And it's not just going to be something that's very easy. I mean, it's going to take some research on the part of the company manager or the safety manager.
Well, yeah, but you also have people, even if it's a small company, you have some folks who have had a course in psychology. Mm-hmm. They've had an introductory psychology course. And right. I might say that the book I would recommend of all the books, I've got almost 30 books, but the book I would recommend that's least expensive and has it all is a book called Actively Caring for People. And it's $25 on our website. And it includes case studies, 6 chapters of the basic principles, stories that people have shared with regard to reaching out and helping others, from a lot on safety. How do we move from compliance to commitment? You know, we're supposed to comply, but commitment means that I'm internally self-directed. That's different. How do we go there? So there's a chapter in this book on that. It's in its fifth edition now. We just added a chapter to our book, by the way, on athletic coaching. How can coaches inspire self-motivation among their athletes? And so we think it'll be of interest now to coaches of sports teams.
Well, you know what? They always talk about bottling lightning, and I think we've just experienced that. You have so much energy and enthusiasm for safety. I think that what I've just heard here in this past half hour has been exactly that, bottled lightning.
Well, first I got to say that I just turned 74 years old. So, you know, for you to say that I still have the enthusiasm and that makes me feel good, because I don't want to slow down. I'm at this as long as I can. I'm on a mission because I know what needs to be done to improve quality of life, from safety to environmental protection to health. I know what needs to be done, and I'm around long enough, and that these books can get out there, and people will read them. And by the way, that's what happens at our safety conference.
And I was just going to ask you about that, the people-based safety conference in August 16th through the 18th, 2016, in Roanoke, Virginia. Tell us about it.
What's really fun about that is I get to talk, and I enjoy that, and our partners get to speak from a practical perspective. And my partners have been there for 20 plus years, so they know how to put this stuff in place. And so it's a 3-day conference where people really interact with each other, and they go from the principles to the applications, and not only applications from consultants, but applications from people who have been there in their culture.
That's great, Scott. Tell the folks how they can sign up.
Absolutely. Go to our website, please, safetyperformance.com. And, you know, I'm very proud of it because it really does bring people out. And it's not a sales pitch. It's instead real-world conversations about how to make it happen. And it's not a program. It's principles, it's processes, and it's applications.
And recapping the books, you have two books on actively caring for people.
Yes, and let me say it again. The book, Actively Caring for People, Cultivating a Culture of Compassion. That's the one that's at our website. That's $25.
Okay.
There's a new one from Cambridge. That's a little more expensive. And that's a 700-page book. And that's much broader than safety. But it's $100 for the hardcover Cambridge book. So, you know, I don't want to put that one down. I'm hoping it's a textbook. And I want colleges and universities to use this new textbook in a course called Applied Psychology. But it's also written for the parent and the safety director.
Mm-hmm.
Cambridge University Press has a website. And you have to purchase that through the Cambridge website.
All right. And for those listening on iTunes or Stitcher, we'll have links to all the things that Dr. Geller has just mentioned in this podcast post at safetyexpertstalk.com. Well, we're just about out of time, Dr. Geller. Any final thoughts on actively caring for people?
Well, Dan, one final thought is I want people to know that when they come to our conference or wherever I go, I learn from them. So Six Sigma means continuous learning. From both perspectives. Listen, I've been at this university, Virginia Tech, for 47 years. I could have retired a long time ago. Quite frankly, I could have made more money by going out on the road and speaking and stuff. But you know what? I'm here at the university because it's a continuous learning process.
Mm-hmm.
Students challenge me to answer their questions. They bring to me their challenges, and then I have to learn. So it's continuous learning, and that's why actively caring for people has evolved from behavior-based safety to people-based safety to actively caring for people. And who knows what's next? But I'm hopeful that AC4P, that's our way of saying it, AC4P, it's going to spread worldwide to keep people looking out for each other for their welfare.
Well, it's a noble cause, and thanks for talking with us. Our guest has been Dr. E. Scott Geller, a founding partner of Safety Performance Solutions and a professor in the Department of Psychology at Virginia Tech. Thanks, Scott.
Thank you, Dan. I appreciate it.
I'm Dan Clark. For 10% off your safety needs at creativesafetysupply.com, go there and use coupon code BIG10.
Thank you for joining us on Safety Experts Talk. If you have suggestions for future podcasts, send them to podcast@creativesafetysupply.com. For more safety experts talking about safety news, OSHA regulations, PPE, Lean, 5S, or continuous improvement, go to creativesafetysupply.com/podcast.